You might think we've learned almost everything there is to know about our planet. We've mapped the tiniest details of every continent and our most remote islands. We've sent explorers to the Earth's poles, the harshest deserts, and the highest mountains. Yet 71% of our planet, our oceans, remains largely unexplored. Only 5% has been explored by humans. And only 25% has been mapped, with limited detail, by sonar systems. We know less about the landscape of the ocean than we do the far side of the moon. Scientists estimate that 2/3 of the ocean species, potentially over 650,000 life forms, excluding microorganisms, remain undiscovered in the ocean's depths. But exploring our oceans is not merely of academic value. The ocean is full of resources vital to our economy, including trillions of dollars of oil, natural gas, and rare earth metals. Understanding the ocean can help us better predict and prepare for tsunamis and other natural disasters. And the discovery, harvesting, and study of new plant life could reveal life-saving medical applications, just as our study of the unique plant life in the Amazon jungle has. So why have we explored so little of our oceans? And what are we doing to explore them now? Let's start at the very beginning. First, humanity had to learn to leave our shores. But going out was a relatively simple problem. The true challenge is going down. Every 10 meters of depth adds an additional atmosphere of pressure for a diver to withstand, not to mention the frigid cold and the lack of air to breathe. Nonetheless, early accounts of deep diving were recorded as far back as 1000 BC. Greek fishermen dived up to 30 meters by holding their breath, grabbing onto a heavy rock, and pouring oil into their ears and mouth to help withstand the pressure. In 332 BC, the first diving bell, an air-filled chamber used to lower a diver into water, was used by Alexander the Great and his soldiers to clear obstructions for his naval assault on the city of Tyre. Fast forward almost 2 millennia to the first submarine, constructed in 1620 by Dutch inventor Cornelius Drebbel on behalf of the English Royal Navy. Drebbel's submarine couldn't take its crew very deep, only up to 5 meters, but it could keep them there for up to 3 hours, and so began a series of inventions that would take humans deeper and deeper for longer and longer. 1715 was a particularly big year for advancements in diving. Englishman John Lethbridge built a barrel with a glass viewing window that divers could be lowered down in. But this creative design paled in comparison to what the French Navy was working on. Sir Pierre Remy de Beauve built the first waterproof diving suit, equipped with lead shoes and a metal helmet with breathing tubes. Although the idea for such a suit dates back to at least German military engineer Konrad Kaiser in the early 15th century. But without the ability for such suits to withstand the deep ocean's pressure, little could be learned about anything too deep by sending humans. Instead, sending down a rope with a lead weight, was used to study the depth of water and topography of the seafloor, and dredging, sending down a net, was used to bring up marine sediment and organisms. With the knowledge available by the mid-19th century, it was scientifically controversial if life could even exist below around 550 meters deep. But Scottish scientist Charles Wyville Thompson for the first time proved it did in 1868 when he dredged up life from almost 4,400 meters down. It was shortly after that the scientific field of oceanography took shape. In 1872, the British HMS Challenger began a 4-year journey traveling the seas. It discovered underwater mountains and hundreds of species of marine life. The 50-volume report from the Challenger expedition is considered to be the basis of modern oceanography. In the first half of the 20th century, the tools available to oceanographers advanced. In 1914, Reginald Fessenden made lead rope sounding obsolete by bouncing literal sound waves off the seafloor, a technique that led to modern sonar. And the military needs of World War II led to further improvements in sonar imaging of objects on the seafloor, as well as the development of deep ocean camera systems. But those with the drive to explore the ocean would stop at nothing less than being able to see it for themselves. The 19th century saw multiple suits designed and manufactured to protect divers from the sea's pressure. The first to see multiple successful dives was French engineer M. de Pluvy's awkward-looking suit in 1906, taking him 90 meters down. Meanwhile, underwater vehicles also advanced. In 1888, the French Navy launched the first electrically powered military submarine. Amongst civilians, a massive breakthrough came in 1930, when William Beebe and Otis Barton's bathysphere made its first dive. They continued to set depth records until they reached their deepest dive of 900 meters in 1934. Beebe and Barton's expeditions were front-page news around the world. While photos couldn't be taken through the bathysphere, illustrations of the foreign world they encountered brought their sights to the masses. Swiss father and son team Auguste and Jacques Picard continued Beebe and Barton's work with their bathyscaphes. Their ultimate goal was set in 1951, when a British sounding revealed what we believe to be the ocean's deepest point, Challenger Deep, 10,929 meters below sea level at the bottom of the Mariana Trench. Challenger Deep is over 2 kilometers deeper than the height of Mount Everest. In 1960, Jacques shocked the scientific community by reaching Challenger Deep, discovering life in one of Earth's most inhospitable environments. His monumental achievement represents perhaps the greatest accomplishment in exploring our planet, but Picard's bathyscaphe could only safely stay at Challenger Deep for 20 minutes. French oceanographer Jacques Cousteau, inventor of the first successful self-contained underwater breathing apparatus, or scuba device, attempted to solve that issue with his Continental Shelf Station project, a series of underwater research laboratories where scientists could live for weeks at a time. The United States also built a series of similar sea labs. However, Sea Lab 3 suffered multiple mechanical failures, and aquanaut Barry Cannon died in a failed attempt to repair the station. In the aftermath, the Sea Lab project was abandoned. So unfortunately, you won't be able to like this video and subscribe to Beyond Now from a deep sea home anytime soon. Deep sea exploration remains extraordinarily dangerous to this day. Any improper manufacturing or damage to a vessel's hull can cause the ocean's immense pressure to destroy it in a split second. This sadly happened to the 5 passengers on board OceanGate's Titan submersible in June of 2023. For this reason, most contemporary deep-sea exploration, like space exploration, uses unmanned vehicles. But also like space exploration, the cost, difficulty, and danger has not deterred the most adventurous among us. For example, James Cameron pivoted his filmmaking success into an opportunity to undertake the second ever crewed voyage and first solo mission to Challenger Deep in 2012, bringing 3D cameras with him. While we still have an enormous distance until we fully understand our oceans, we've progressed by leaps and bounds. Efforts to expand our knowledge continue. Since the 1980s, satellite radar beams have helped to map the ocean floor, providing more data than we've ever had before. In 2019, a team of scientists won a $4 million prize, sponsored in part by Shell Oil, for developing revolutionary ocean mapping technology that uses a combination of uncrewed surface vessels, autonomous underwater vehicles, and cloud-based data processing. The International Seabed 2030 project plans to produce a definitive map of the world ocean floor by 2030 by using a dozen tracking ships outfitted with advanced multi-beam bathymetry technology. However, increasing multi-beam technology is being swapped out for even more advanced laser-based radar, or LIDAR, which can see the ocean floor with even more detail. For the private sector, the UN's International Seabed Authority will finalize regulations for deep-sea mining in 2025, after which we can expect such efforts by businesses to expand rapidly. With so little of the ocean yet explored, it's hard to know what the far future of ocean exploration will bring, but given all the interest in the possibility of extraterrestrial life, perhaps people ought to be a little more curious about what still undiscovered life lives here on Earth alongside us. For those who want to travel to and terraform Mars and beyond, Restarting projects like C-Lab and learning how to make inhospitable environments livable could provide applicable lessons to use across the galaxy. And while it might sound less grand, the vast resources available beneath the seas are no less important for human civilization. In addition to oil and natural gas, deep sea mining could provide an abundance of lithium, cobalt, and graphite, which are critical for electric vehicle batteries, wind turbines, and solar panels, helping to move humanity to low-carbon, renewable energy sources. And with reserves of gold, silver, and rare earth elements, deep-sea mining can ameliorate scarcity and the accompanying conflict over resources that sparks violence, promoting peace and prosperity for all of us around the world. Would you travel to the bottom of the ocean if you had the chance, even knowing the danger? How long do you think you could live in a sea lab? Join the conversation and predict the future with us down in the comments. At Beyond Now, we seek to help humanity learn from our past and prepare for our future by studying the subjects that can allow our species to advance. In addition to liking, commenting, and subscribing, we hope you'll also consider supporting Beyond Now by becoming a patron and part of our community of learners and thinkers.